Something else to do, right? Still have to track them, sort of, so. Bob, I'm watching you.
Okay. Let's see, we've just gone and you've kind of looked at, simulate as closely as possible what it is the student is going to experience when he or she actually goes to work. And so that's what we've attempted to do in this this area, this L-shaped part of this, is to establish what we've called an automated office area, primarily for the secretarial students, the executive secretary, the legal secretary, the medical secretary. But there are a number of other students that can take advantage of it, and as we more fully develop the multidisciplinary approach, we expect that to happen. But we provided the furnishings that are flexible and yet respond to what we think that the modern automated office looks like and needs to be able to function like. And then in addition, each one of the workstations for the information handling, information processing, we've gone with the microcomputer. We think that that has a great deal more flexibility over dedicated word processing systems. And so it, each station has... business data processing majors, all other students that enter the program of study fall of 1985 must take 1 3-credit course in microcomputer applications. And that course is not a programming course. A course is an applications course, in which they deal with spreadsheets, they deal with word processing, they deal with graphics, they deal with communications, they deal with different databases. We want our students to be able to have an understanding of the capability that the microcomputer has in an application setting, and for the non-business data processing major. The electronic students take it, the auto mechanic students take it, the, well, all the other students, commercial arts students, take it. Our need is to get it up to 50 students. We have one more speed here. Students are in Saturday, they're here all the time. So it's one of the, probably the highest use lab that we have in the center.
My name is Doug Fox, and I'm the one that you get blamed if this program goes on longer than it's supposed to. This is truly an important event for this institution and for the entire state of Oklahoma. It's one that I think each of you can take pride in being a part of, and that a state collectively is bound to take pride in over generations to come. The story is told of Oliver Wendell Holmes, the eminent jurist, when he was in his 80s. He boarded a train, sat down, and a few minutes later the conductor came for him and asked for his ticket. He fumbled around, and couldn't find the ticket. But fortunately, the conductor recognized who he was, and he said, "Well, Mr. Justice Holmes, I feel rather certain, knowing who you are, that you did buy a ticket, and that the Pennsylvania Railroad can trust you, and that surely you'll turn in the ticket once you discover it." Justice Holmes hesitated for a minute, and he said, "Well, young man, that's only part of the problem." He said, "Part of my problem is that I can't find my ticket. My real problem is that I don't know where I'm going." There are those in the midst of Oklahoma's current economic and cultural plight who would suggest that we don't know where we're going. But as one observer of the Oklahoma educational scene, I am here to attest to the fact that you are participating today with an institution which knows where it's going, and with a facility that has a clear sense of direction leading directly to the 21st century. What's happening here this afternoon, it's a dedication of building and equipment, to be sure. But properly understood, it's a dedication to ideas. Those ideas, briefly stated, are the ideas of advancing technology and of dealing with change. Two ideas of utmost significance for everyone in this room and everyone in this state. This is but a part of that movement, but an important part. I'd like now to introduce those at the podium. I'm going to ask each, as I introduce them, to stand, remain standing, and with the usual request and admonition that you withhold applause until all have been introduced. On the back row to my right, Reverend Roger Spencer, who gave the invocation, the pastor of the Presbyterian Church in Okmulgee. Next to him, Julia Boyd, a student of this institution from whom you'll hear more later. To her left, Edna Mae Phelps, the vice chair of the OSU Board of Regents. To her left, Jim Swank, president of Anchor Moco Industries in Tulsa. Staying on this side, being a Republican, I always start at the right. The director of Oklahoma State University Technical Branch of Okmulgee, Dr. Bob Clavis. Next to him, Dr. Joe Parker, trustee of the Noble Foundation. And now to my left. In the back row, we have Janet Cote, who sang the national anthem for us. Next to her, Robin Smith, the president of the Student Senate. Next to him, Mr. Carlisle Mabry, the mayor of Okmulgee. And in the front row on my left, Dr. Joe Leone, the Chancellor of the Regents of Higher Education, Dr. Larry Bunker, President of Oklahoma State University, and a man from whom you'll also be hearing more later, Mr. Jim Harkins. And if I got fewer than three names wrong, that's ahead of my average for this kind of thing. Head of the committee, his career has gone from Tulsa to the moon, back to northeastern Oklahoma. He presently co-hosts PBS series Over Easy, which by a strange coincidence has also been nominated for an Emmy. Talented, gifted, dedicated, visionary, with roots in Oklahoma. What more can an introducer say about a man of Jim Harkins' stature? Welcome, Jim Harkins.
First of all, I want to thank the people who were responsible for inviting me to be here. I had a wonderful tour of the facility this morning. When you leave your hometown, when you're at the tender age that I was back in the 60s, and come back occasionally, as I have over the years, the most embarrassing thing is to get lost in your hometown, because so many buildings, so many expressways, so many new schools, so many wonderful institutions have been built up in the time that you've been gone, in things that were previously vacant lots and fields and streets that went nowhere. So it is such a pleasure to come back and to see something like this, to be here and to be thriving and to be providing for the economic well-being and the educational well-being of my home state. It is always a pleasure. I thank you for the tour this morning. We had a wonderful time. As they say, the only difference between men and boys is the price of their toys. And I just found out where I wanted to be as a boy, except it wasn't here. But the great thing is that what we're looking at here is not toys. These are the working models of where our young people are going to be going in their futures. And it is such a pleasure and such a source of pride for me as an Oklahoman to see this environment that so resembles the actual working place. I was invited last fall to teach a course at my alma mater, the University of Tulsa, and it had the very prosaic title of Advanced Television Journalism. And the subtitle of it was Out of the Ivory Tower and Into the Moat. The problem with many young people is when they go out of the ivory tower, they are into the moat. And the great thing about OSU Tech here is I think it is preparing them as well or better than any place that I've ever seen to jump into that moat and get across it into the real world. I'm proud to be here too because I think places like OSU Tech are going to be vital to our future. It'll make a strong difference because we are in, I think, a budding crisis. And the answer is not to turn back to simpler times. This crisis, I think, has been building for a long time. It really burst onto the public conscious this last fall, spring, last fall, winter, and spring with the catastrophic failures of three of our most celebrated rocket programs, the Shuttle, the Titan, and the Delta. This is something that I've been very closely allied with for many years. These machines were the cutting edge of American science and technology. The finest minds had conceived them, had built them, and launched them, and then in an instant, they had not just veered off course, not just failed to meet all of the objectives, but had been blown into a million pieces. We had some warning of this is what is probably the third industrial revolution that we've gone through. The question is, what do we do with them? Because the machines have to do more than run. And what are we going to do without them when they don't run? Because at one time or another, they will not run. Less than 5 years after the start of the big home computer boom, we now have more home computers stored in basements than we have Lionel trains. And we are soon going to find out that simply being a computer programmer is not enough. The programs have to do something besides run. And the best model that I know to illustrate the point is Thomas Edison, the man who still holds the record for American patents. He was not a dilettante. He was not a tinkerer. He was not just fooling around. He set out from scratch to make the things that people needed and wanted. He organized the first independent mass research and development laboratories. He created from nothing, and he wasn't working out of his garage when he retired. The Edison laboratories and factories covered hundreds of acres in New Jersey. He said, we're going to set out to do one or two small things every week and one or two big things every single week, and that they themselves will become self-perpetuating. About a year ago in Washington, we've had there for a long time, an institution called the Folger Shakespeare Theater. And the Folger Theater got in trouble financially. And there was an announcement made that they were going to close the theater but keep the research library open until there was a vast outcry. The point being simple, Shakespeare wrote plays, and if we can't see his plays, what's the point of anything else? Plays the thing, he said. 13 years ago, I was in the Middle East covering Israeli Arab War. And in the midst of it, Isaac Stern, violinist, and his protege, Pinky Zimmerman, both canceled European tours and came to play for the young soldiers in hospitals who were wounded. And I was assigned to go follow around Isaac Stern for a few days, and he ended up playing a huge free concert in the auditorium in Tel Aviv. And they packed the hall to hear this. The only price of admission was to bring something that the troops could use in front of portable radio and toothpaste.
For the rest on the podium, that ain't a tough act to follow, but it's impossible. The word foundation, like the word corporation, is generally viewed as a very impersonal one in Oklahoma and elsewhere. To most of us, if we're honest, the word foundation is roughly
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here and see this building. I get rather emotional. That's probably old age. But it's a first-class job, and the people involved in the design and building of this building should be complimented. And I know that we in the Noble Foundation appreciate all the work and realize the magnitude of the job. We are proud to be a part of this operation. We look forward to more. The foundation, for your interest, was formed by Lloyd Noble in honor of his father, Samuel Roberts Noble, in 1945. Lloyd died young, 1950, at the age of 53, and the bulk of his fortune went into the foundation. This was in the form of stock in Noble Drilling and Sandin Oil. This grew from the recorded sum at that time, 9 million
students. For them, for their learning, for their advancement, and their generation, that we're all here together. We're going to hear now from Julia Boyd, who is the Noble Foundation Scholarship recipient from Idabella, Oklahoma, who is here majoring in marketing and management. Let's hear it for Julia and the students.
To you on this memorable occasion. The Samuel Roberts Noble Foundation Scholarship has been a great asset to me, and I'm glad to get a chance to thank the people responsible for it. By providing my tuition, it has allowed me to work less at my job and focus more attention on
this institution. Really doesn't go back very far to any real degree. It's only been 2.5 years. But during that time, I had institutions are the shadow of one great man. I think what is happening here, with all due respect to everything that came before, is very much the product of the shadow of one great educator. I'm proud to introduce Dr. Robert Clemens, the director of this institution.
Thank you, Doug. Distinguished platform members, honored guests, students, faculty, and employees, please allow me to say thanks and express the deepest appreciation to each of you for your support.
You was the principal university in the state. I was wrong there, too. OSU has done, with the resources available to it, what I would consider to be nothing short of a marvelous job. Again, for much the same reason we're talking about this institution, there's a reason for this. The leader of that institution is not one whose picture is on the front pages every couple of days. He tends to have a style of quiet leadership, but don't let that mislead you. There is strength, there is determination, there is administrative talent, there is management, and today's cliche, but it fits, again, vision. I'm proud to introduce Dr. Lawrence Booker.
Thank you, Doug. I can't help but smile as I come forward after an introduction like that. I'm glad you feel that way. You say confessions are good for the soul. I thank you. And I thank you, Jim Parks, for that most appropriate and eloquent presentation. It fits so beautifully with the objectives of all of us who have had any part to do with the development of this institution, laying the foundation for where we want to go. And those words coming from a person of your stature adds immeasurably to this day. So I thank you. Also, want to thank all of you for your presence here. I well remember Wayne Miller calling on me, announcing that he had $1 million committed. The grant was $1.5 million. The other $500,000 endowed the scholarships that Julie talked about. But $1 million required matching. And Wayne's idea of matching was $2 million.
The program has many other objectives, which we will continue during the coming months and years. We are excited about the future and the technological exploration and development, which will take place in the coming years. And we hope each of you will have many opportunities to return to this institution as we move forward. And I wish to take this opportunity to thank our distinguished platform members, honored guests, students and faculty, and employees for your commitment to this institution. After the closing remarks by our Master of Ceremonies, the platform members will gather at the time capsule to my right, deposit their
contact. All right, good to come. Good to see you, Bob.
Good to see you.
You know one of them.
Hi. I've talked to you on the phone. I haven't met her. Nice to meet you.
Good job.
Thank you. Glad you're here. Did a nice job. Thank you for coming. Really appreciate it. Thank you very much. Chancellor, thanks very much.